Bible says, book of Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 1st verse. We're bored to have the University of Charleston men's basketball team with us this morning. Prepare for their conference run for the championship. Coach G suggested this is the best team he's had since he's been at UC. So we think short of a conference championship and a tournament championship, the number one seed, we will not accept. 1 Timothy chapter 6, I'd like to read verses 11 through 16. 1 Timothy 6, verses 11 through 16. And I'm reading this morning from the New King James. But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called after confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I urge you in the sight of God, who gives life to all things, and before Christ Jesus, who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep these commandments without spot, blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ appearing, which he will manifest in his own time, he who is the blessed and the only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality dwelling in the light, whom no man has seen or can see. We are an everlasting power. Lord, this blessing be upon the reading of our hearts. Father, the word given, that we pray that you will fall on us, you will the eyes of our undisclosed glories, like the ball, that we see Jesus in the center of the hearts of the earth be open to the peace of Lord Christ, that by us we can revive the pride, the downcast earth, Lord, he lifted all that be exhausted on us. Amen. Where's Brother Russell? Brother Corey landed with us in the official capacity as a youth pastor, and he's been just a tremendous asset to our church. And so he may have had to leave, but I'm going to speak to him. This is going to be a sort of to Brother Corey. And the apostle sort of captures it very eloquently in these few verses of scripture. And I hope that also he might be encouraging the other young people here this morning. You know, we are privileged in life if we have the opportunity to have mentors, older people, more mature people, that will take the time to show us the way so that we can benefit and we can prosper from their experiences. The wise person learns from their own mistakes. The wiser person learns from other people's mistakes. That's the wiser person, who's able to learn from someone else's mistakes and therefore be able to chart their course to not fall to the same sins, not make the same mistakes that someone else made, but to learn from other people's mistakes. And so one of the reasons the church is so important is because the church brings together this great, diverse collection of individuals from varied and sundry backgrounds and experiences, and collectively we become something very unique and something very special. And that's why it troubles my heart to see this great exodus from the church today. You look in churches, even within our church, there are not a lot of young people in terms of those teenage years where life is really starting to make up its mind. And where they're being bombarded by those critical decisions that they have to make. The peer pressure, they're assaulted by a philosophy that has a world in life view that basically says, just leave God out. Make your own decision, just leave God out. Don't weigh or don't contemplate what God's word has to say about this situation. Make your own decision. You're your own person, your own man, your own woman. Do your own thing. And that is a philosophy that really is permeating our society today. We are sort of mesmerized with this idea of individualism. We want to be our own individual person. And so we want to make our own decisions. And we want to use our own standard for righteousness and our own standard for excellence. And we end up in a state of relativism where we're having difficulty distinguishing between right and wrong. And that is a great, great peril for young people today. They're having difficulty distinguishing between right and wrong, because there's a society that's espousing a world and life view that basically says if it feels good, then do it. That's basically saying that the chief end of the human experience is to have pleasure, recreation, and entertainment. And so we just pursue the next party. We're always looking for the good time. And we seldom find young people really sitting down and giving serious, thoughtful consideration to what type of future am I making for myself with my decisions I make today. Your destiny is determined by the decisions you make on a daily basis. But most young people never contemplate that. They assume that they always have time to get it right. They always have time to recover from a bad choice or bad decision or from a mistake. And that's erroneous. We don't always have time to recover. Time is never an ally. Every decision is critical, because every decision is making a plank in determining what my future is going to be. That was Paul's concern. The Apostle Paul was greatly concerned about his young mentee, a young man by the name of Timothy. And so when you read 1 and 2 Timothy, this is basically an old sage, an old dude, trying to give a good word of instruction and encouragement to a young lion, a young man by the name of Timothy. And Paul was trying to equip Timothy to deal with the pressures and the problems that he would encounter as a young minister in a society that would be very hostile to his faith and to his belief system. And so Paul knew that everything that was true and honest and just and pure and that was righteous, then it would constantly be assaulted. And there is always a trying to erode away a righteous base, a righteous standard, a pure ethic. And so he's trying to undergird Timothy in the faith. So if you pick up in verse 1 of 1 Timothy 6, Paul gives some general directives. Just general directives. He speaks to the servants, those who are under masters. And if you understand the New Testament time the Bible was written, the Roman government was the world empire. And so the Roman subjugated the known world at that time. And most people were servants or slaves of some type. And so what Paul was saying to Timothy and to those people who found themselves in that situation is that we don't get to choose the world that we come into. We don't get to choose the family, the situation, or the circumstance in which we enter the world. And we don't get to choose a lot of the influences that are brought to bear on our lives. Are you with me? But what our choices are, how do we respond to our environment? How do we respond to the situation, the circumstance that we find ourselves in? So many people in Rome were born into slavery. It wasn't a choice. They were born into families, but families were servants or slaves. They were born into that situation. And so what Paul says to them, that even born into slavery, you can make the best out of a bad situation if you yield your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if your ambition, goal in life is to serve God. That's what Paul says in verse 1. He says, so if you're in a servant situation, then honor your master. Show your master the respect that he or she is entitled to because of their position, so that the doctrine of God, that the word of God, is not blasphemed. You know, I work with a lot of people during the week. And there are a lot of people that are unemployable, that may not be a word, but it sounds good. They are unemployable. They're looking for employment, but they are basically unemployable. Some of them are unemployable because they do not have the basic skill requisite that's required to obtain employment. They don't have a skill set that someone's willing to pay them for. Others are unemployable because they don't have the right attitude to be employed. They simply don't have the right attitude to be employed. They can't get there on time. They always got an excuse. They can't follow instructions. They won't do things the way they think they ought to be done and then expect for someone to pay them every 2 weeks. They're basically unemployable. I try to tell the young people that they're not reserving a block of jobs in our society for people who just look good. They're just not doing it anymore. You have to bring something to the party. And attitude is half of the battle. If you just show up with the right attitude, a willingness to work, a willingness to apply yourself, a willingness to do what it takes to get the job done, that is half of the battle. It's half the battle. And so it goes in school. I've never seen a teacher yet that did not want to teach a student who wanted to learn. If you want to learn, 99% of the teachers who teach in the public school system, they salivate to get a classroom full of students who really and truly want to learn. They're trained as educators. But what's happened then, many kids are unteachable. And the reason that they are unteachable is because they got a bad attitude. Can't nobody tell them anything. They know what Master P said. They know what Nas said. They know what Snoop said. They know what everybody said, what the book says. Come on, right. And the problem is, they don't give an offer a class as a requisite for graduation was what's the latest hip-hop tunes. And I'm not hating on the rappers. But attitude determines your altitude, and attitude also determines whether or not people want to help you. Are y'all going to help me? So Paul gives a general directive to Timothy and a general directive to us to say, if you show up with the right attitude, half the battle is already won. And if you recognize that someone has paid the price or paid the cost to be in a position of leadership, if you can recognize and respect that, you can find your place. You can find your place in an organization, in an institution, a place where you can be a contributing member of the team. So he says, even if you're born into slavery, there's an attitude that you can have that you can serve God and you can be a blessing to other people and God can use your life as a witness. The second directive Paul gives is in verse 3. He says, if anyone teaches otherwise and does not consider the wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words from which come into strife, reveling, suspicion, useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. From such withdraw yourself. So Paul, in this second paragraph, he challenges the prevailing mindset of that day. And the prevailing mindset of that day was materialism, the acquisition of goods and things, that was synonymous with godliness. So if you had stuff, if you had things, you had trinkets and toys, if you had the right clothes and the right chariots and the right beasts of burdens, then you must be a godly person. Now there is a prevailing thought today that the chief end of the human experience is to acquire stuff. And he or she who has the most stuff in the end, that's who wins. That's not true. Paul says there are some who would say that godliness is a means of gain. And then he goes on to say, from such withdraw yourself, but godliness with contentment is great gain. Paul says the acquisition of material things, it is not synonymous with godliness. He says, but when you have true godliness, true righteousness, you will have contentment. A sense of divine tranquility that will enable you to lead a productive, fruitful, contentful life. I have never seen so many unhappy, dissatisfied people in my life with so much stuff. I've never seen it on this wise before. I've never seen so many people with sour attitudes and bad attitudes because they don't have the latest this or the new that. And they aren't dripping in this or aren't dripping in that. It has become cultic. Shopping has become almost a cult, a form of religion in our society. Y'all might as well say amen. Y'all don't tell me. It's become a form of a religion. Shopping till you drop. But Paul says it's godliness with contentment. He says, for we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. Then he uses something basic and fundamental. He says, everybody who came in this world, no one came out of their mother's womb in designer clothes. Nobody came out with FUBU or with Nike or with Starlet. Nobody. Everybody came in this world butt naked in their birthday suit. And Paul said that's the exact same way you want out. He said that people might show you the decency to put a garment of clothing on you so you can look nice laying in the coffin. He said, but where you really going in heaven or hell, you're not going to take those clothes with you. He said, you brought nothing into this world, and sure, you're going to take nothing out. You will never see a U-Haul following a hearse to the graveyard. You brought nothing into this world, and you're going to take nothing out. Nothing out. And it's amazing that our focus is upon the material things, the here and the now, those things which are temporal, which do not bring peace of mind and contentment and a sense of purpose and meaning and direction. And so we get the latest thing, it's tore up, man, we're frustrated. Some of y'all already, boy, stuff, prison's already broke. And you lost the receipt, you can't take it back. It's not even paid for yet. More clothes, you know when you bought them, they were too small. With no way to work, you can get that 16 and a 12. But you bought it in. And now you're frustrated because it's hanging in the closet, you can't get in. Preacher, man. He said you bought nothing in. You take nothing out. And your sense of meaning and purpose will not come from the acquisition of goods and things. Nor will it come from the acquisition of position and status and prominence in the society. We was at a basketball game the other night, and a young man came up to me. He said, Rev, he said, could you play as good as your son can play? Now my first instinct was in the way. I used to put fear in the hearts of men. And I thought about that day for a while. And I thought about that morning when I got up. And I couldn't raise my shoulder. Couldn't raise my shoulder with my head. I said, where did that come from? Got a kick in my shoulder. And I was doing something with my wife because I was trying to clean the carpet for the holidays and something hit me down my back. And I said, before I say anything, let me just pass on that question. And I'll say these young men from the University of Charleston, they put on their basketball uniforms, they all look like bodybuilders, muscles ripping everywhere. But after a while, by the by. After a while, by the by. Edwards won't be the soul like he can soar now and slam dunk. It'll just be a memory. I watched this commercial. I told you I watched commercials, man. I'm into these commercials. They got this one commercial about this dip. They got Dominique Wilkins, and Dominique Wilkins was a human highlight player. I mean, Dominique Wilkins did things that you didn't think were possible on the basketball court. And I can see him doctoring up the video where he's running across the court like he's going to jump up and dip his chip down in that dip that's up on top of the basket. Dominique gets about this far off the floor. And I said, my. After a while, by and by, time has a way of wearing on these old bodies. Not only do our clothes wear out, but our bodies start to wear out, our bodies start to slow down, and we start to realize that we were not put here to stay. And we start to realize even our athletic and our physical prowess, it will fail us. What are we really valuing? What are we really acquiring? What are we really investing our time and our efforts and our energy into becoming? As I shared with you before, we can spend all of our time trying to become something that is temporal. But we focus on becoming something that is eternal, a man of God, a woman of God, a young person of God. It's not something you start to do after a while. You do it every single day. You invest in your spiritual life every day. You invest in prayer every day, in Bible study every day. You go through your spiritual calisthenics every day. And in so doing, you're strengthening yourself spiritually for the long haul. And if you live long enough, you're going to have to know how to pray for yourself. how to pray, how to go through hard times and difficult times.
Yes, sir.
That's what Paul is saying to Timothy. So he warns them. He warns them about being deceived into thinking that the acquisition of material things will bring contentment and happiness, and the pursuit of wealth has been the highest goal in the human experience. Now I must admit, this past week, every time I would go into Kenora City, I would see the sign, lottery, 280 million. 280 million. I've never bought a lottery ticket in my life. But even I was tempted to go and buy me a ticket. Because I had some numbers dancing around in my head. This might be lucky. And then a brother down in Putnam County hit the lottery. $117 million after tax. And I saw the newspaper where he was going to donate to three churches. I ran to the church. I got all the business cards. Has he ever been here? Has he ever been here? Just maybe, maybe. That's our ship coming in. But I say, God bless him. And God bless the three churches that he's going to support. And all the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, all those who dwell in. The Lord is maybe going to bring some of those resources back to the kingdom of God. But it's godliness with contentment. I was reading the newspaper yesterday, early this morning, actually. Yesterday's paper, early this morning, the day behind. And I was like, come on, Master P. This is your boy, Master P, right? He's worth about $500 million at least. And so what they do is, and I don't know whether he did it or someone else did it, but they recorded this old lady's voice on the telephone. And then put her voice on their album. Without her knowing about it. And then they didn't want to give a woman no money for it. And so the court ruled that she was entitled to like $105,000 or whatever it is because they had violated some rights. Well, get a sister some money, man. You got $500 million. Boy, 8 years old. Get a sister some money. But it's amazing that the more people have, the more they try to hoard. And I'm not hating on Master P. I kind of like Master P. He has a kind of incredible story coming up with the project that Louisiana, you know, come up a hard way, son is out on the back of his car, that type of business. I don't like all the stuff he do, but I admire his spirit, his tenacity. Take care of his wife, take care of his kids, trying to be a man. But pay the sister the money that you owe. Greed has a way of warping your view. And so when you focus on acquiring stuff and obtaining things, you're always concerned about somebody taking it away from you. And so you spend more trying to keep something than it would have cost us to do the right thing. That's what Paul was saying. Verse 9, I'm going to be through in a minute. Verse 8, he says, but having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. Now this is not good for TV preacher, radio preacher to tell folk you ought to be satisfied with food and clothing. Paul said, with just food enough in your stomach and clothing on your back, if you're out of the elements when it's cold and hot, you'll be grateful and thankful to God. That's all it takes to serve God. If God sustains us physically with what we need to have the health and strength to propel our bodies, then we can be content in serving God. Now, I don't hate money. Don't get me wrong. Don't misunderstand. So like Tony Brown said, if money is not the most important thing in the world. He said, but it ranks right there with oxygen. I don't know if I'll write you that high, but hey, it's got a place there. So don't think there's anything wrong with it. If God blesses you with talent and with skill and with ability, and if you can parlay it out in the community, you go out there and you make as much money as you can make. But you make it in the right way, with dignity and with honor and with integrity. And if you get it, then be grateful to God that you have it. And then use it in a way to bring glory to God and to satisfy the needs of your family and friends and family and so forth. So we need young people of stature and influence out in society. We need millionaires and billionaires who are Christians, who can control resources, who can finance ministry, who can do things. And God can raise some of us up to do that. But Paul said that should not be our preoccupation. He said, for those who desire to be rich fall into the temptation of snare and to many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many signs. Paul says some people have strayed away from the truth. They strayed away from the narrow and the straight because they were deceived by greed and materialism. And how many times do you find young people getting themselves involved in illegal activity? It's easy to justify doing something illegal if you buy into the wrong value system. You see, if you buy into the wrong value system that says, I am entitled to have everything that they sell at the mall or in East Dallas, I'm entitled to have it because they make it. And since they make it, I'm entitled to have it. And since the people that I revere and respect, they got it, and they say I need it, then I'm entitled to have it. So then you can start playing all types of games in your head and convincing yourself that you are deprived in some great way. And you can find yourself involved in illegal activity. I do not know, listen to me, I do not know many people who get involved in illegal activity who do it because they're starving to death. I don't know, man. Matter of fact, I don't know one. I don't know a single person who's gotten involved in something illegal because they were starving to death. They got involved because they wanted to live a lifestyle that they could not finance with their current occupation. They got involved because they wanted to live a lifestyle that did not have the skill set to generate the income that they needed to live that type of lifestyle, not because they were hungry. You might as well say amen. Not because they were hungry. And so we got to learn to distinguish between needs and greeds. Needs and just appetites that we have that someone else is generating that's created inside of us. Some of us in here today, you're sitting in here and you're looking fabulous, and God bless you all. But you're wearing clothes that you don't even know where you are. You didn't wake up one day and say, I'm going to buy me some Gloria Vanderbilt's. Bill Black, Pierre Cardin. You couldn't even pronounce the words. Somebody else convinced you that that's what you should be wearing. Someone else introduced you to that line of goods and clothing, and they said, this is what people ought to be wearing if they're going to be with it. And I have no harm or no problem with you wearing all those things, but understand this is a mind game that's been played on us to try to create dissatisfaction with us to where we walk and do crazy things. But here's what Paul said as we close. Here's what I say to Brother Corey Robinson as he prepares to leave. And to these young people here this morning. Verse 11, but you, O man of God, O woman of God, flee these things. There's some things you got to run from. There's some things you have to run from. And Paul says this insatiable greed, you got to run from it. If not, it will pierce you through with many sorrows. He said, well, flee from these things and pursue righteousness. There's some things you run from and other things you run to. Amen. You run from lust. You run from it. Amen. You run from it. Lustful passion, you can't reason with them because lust does not know reason. Amen. It doesn't know reason. And so if you want to stay pure as a young person, as a young man or a young woman, then you've got to plan to do it by keeping yourself out of situations where your desires will not be fed like a flame because it does not know reason. So some things you got to run from. So he said you run from lustful passion. You run from lustful desires. You put up hedges. You put up fences to keep yourself out of situations and circumstances that you know you can't handle, you run from it. He said, but you pursue, you run after righteousness and godliness. You run after righteousness and godliness. If this nation is going to be spared, it will be because there will be a generation of young people that rise up and decide they're going to run after righteousness and godliness. Our country today is being run by a bunch of people that are materialistic, they're selfish, and they're narcissistic, and it's starting to catch up with us. WorldCom, Enron, this is about a bunch of greedy thugs. These people got a street thug mentality. They just do it with business suits on. They don't care nothing about the economy. They don't care anything about this nation. All they care about is living plush lifestyle with more money than what they ever could spend. It's materialism. It is greed. And it's destroying this country. And so we need righteous people in the business world. We need righteous people in the political arena. This whole fiasco with Trent Lott. A bunch of hypocrites in Washington. A bunch of hypocrites is what it is. I don't know Trent Lott. But how in the world, if people knew certain things about Trent Lott all this time, why had they done something before now? I said, leave the man alone. Leave him alone. They should have left him right where he was in the position he was in. A bunch of hypocrites. Only when it looks like it's a political issue, when it looks like political power is going to be shifted, all of a sudden people get integrity and want to stand up for the truth. The only hope for this country is young folk who start to pursue righteousness and godliness. Righteousness and godliness raise up a generation of people who are committed to the truth and committed to righteousness and godliness. And you young people, you think I'm just spouting this stuff out. This is your country. This is your world. And folk are making a mess out of it. It's not going to be much left for you if you don't stand up and become righteous and godly in God's hands so that God can use you. Let me tell you something. I'm not a politician. I don't know what they're doing over in the Middle East. I'm going to tell you what. This war with Iraq, it scares me to death. We got 60,000 troops right now mobilized over there. Talk about 250,000 over the next couple of months. Talk about we're going to run all the way through Iraq. It's a foregone, but we're just going to drive all the way through the country. I don't know what's going on over there, but I'll tell you what. We're going to make sure we're righteous. This don't turn to be our Waterloo. We're going to make sure we're righteous in what we're getting ready to do. Because what appears to be a certain victory, if God raises up a standard against us, and if God says, I'm tired of your arrogance, your materialism, and your selfishness, if God says, I'm tired of your preoccupation with controlling the world's resources, so that you can use up all the oil and all the natural resources, and God says, I'm tired of it, we're in trouble. We're in trouble. God is our only hope. God is our only source of strength. So I'm trying to say to young people, it's time for you to decide to be the men and women of God. And just maybe God will spare this country because a generation of righteous young folks stand and say, Lord, we'll do it your way. Just food and bread, we'll be satisfied with it. And we got to go back to riding bicycles, Lord, and be righteous, we'll ride bicycles and be righteous. And not only righteous, we'll be more healthy at the same time. But you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness and godliness, faith, love, and patience. Fight the good fight of faith. There's a good fight to be fought, young folks. There's a good fight to be fought. It is the good fight of faith. A faith in God, a faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, a faith in His Word, a faith in God and truth and His promises. Fight the good fight of faith. Don't spend all the days of your youth on frivolous things, on trivial things, on games. There are some weighty issues that you as young people need to be thinking about in this country, in the great United States of America. Y'all go to college, study history, and you'll find any time there's been any great movement in this country because young people have called a vision for a better society. And young people want to sacrifice and give their lives if necessary, as they will give their lives in Iraq. Young men and young women giving their lives to ideals that they believe in. And that's why we are praying for those in the military forces. They still are the great heroes of our society. Who leave this country and go thousands of miles away into harm's way. We didn't know they'll never come back home. And we're to pray for them. They're true heroes. Young folk. With courage and fire. And so what I'm believing in, God will raise up a generation of young people. And we catch a vision for the things of God. Catch a vision for the things of God and realize that there's no greater investment they can make of their lives than invest their lives in the things of God. So as I close, this is what Paul said to Timothy. Verse 12 again, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life to which you also called and have confessed the good confession, in the presence of many witnesses. I urge you in the sight of God, who gives life to all things before Christ Jesus, who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ appearing, which he will make manifest in his own time, he who is blessed and the only potentate, King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality and dwelleth in inapproachable life, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. Well, as our good brother, Corey Robinson, prepares to make his pilgrimage to the great state of Georgia, the Atlanta Metroplex, we want to leave him with a good word. He has fought a good fight here.
Amen.
And among many witnesses all through this county, you mentioned the name Corey Robinson, it's synonymous with sacrificial service to the youth of this community. Sacrificial service, trying to help these young people, tell them the right thing, show them the right way, invest his time and talent and energy in them. Amen? So I just want to say to Brother Corbin, when you come into your kingdom there in Atlanta, and when you rise up and go to chief spokespersons in Atlanta, and when you're pastoring one of those big urban churches, 10,000, 15,000 folks. And when you got the TV ministry on BET, just remember me. Remember good people at Grace Bible Church were praying for you. And they were praying that God would extend your boundaries, your spirit influence, that God would raise you up and give you a national and international platform to proclaim the unsearchable riches of Christ.
Amen.
And I want some of you young people, I want you to just to watch. Watch what God is doing. Brother Corey's life. Watch what he's doing in Brother Keith Tyler's life. Watch what he's doing. These are the type of men that you need to be following and looking at. They're the type of young men that you need to be emulating, using as an example. God is using them, and God is going to use them to do even greater things. And the future of this country rests on the shoulders of young men like Corey Robinson and Keith Tyler. And those are the type of young men we need to see God raise up. The type of young women we need to see God raise up. And in this church, some of you have the potential to soar like Brother Corey and Brother Keith. But you got to decide you're going to fight the good fight.
Amen.
You got to decide you're going to fight the good fight. You got to decide you're not going to allow yourself to be entangled with all this craziness that's going on in society. That you really and truly want to be on the Lord's side.
Amen.
And you really want to reach your spiritual potential for the glory of God. That's your choice. And my only word of encouragement to you is don't let the opportunity pass you by. The opportunity to really and truly be used by God in a most significant way to influence other young people for the kingdom of God. I'm going to ask you to bow with me if you would right now. In the quiet and intimacy of your own heart. First question I want you to ask yourself is, am I a Christian? Am I a Christian? Have I received Jesus Christ in my heart as my Savior? If I were to die at this moment, am I sure that heaven would be my eternal home? If you cannot say with absolute certainty, yes, I know that if I were to die today, that heaven would be my eternal home. If you cannot say with absolute certainty, yes, then you need to give serious consideration. Receiving Jesus Christ as a personal Savior.
Yes, Lord.
He died on the cross for you. He shed his blood for you. That you could be forgiven. That I could be forgiven. If you have a desire today to know that your sins are forgiven, know that you're saved for certain. If you want to be saved, just raise your hand right where you are. God bless you. I see those hands. And just hold on. Don't be ashamed. God bless you. I see those hands. Just hold your hand. Just hold your hand. If you want to be saved.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
I know some of you have been through some things. Even as young people, you've been through some difficulty. But God loves you. Jesus Christ died for you on the cross that you might be saved. Is there another? Those of you who raised your hand, right where you are, I want you to pray this prayer. And someone's going to come and get with you and pray with you and counsel you from the Word of God. Right where you are, right in your seat, I want you to pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know that I've broken your law. And I'm sorry. I believe that you love me. You died for me on the cross of Calvary. That you shed your blood for my sins. I receive you into my heart by faith. I trust you as my Savior by faith. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you for those who prayed that prayer. And I pray right now your Holy Spirit would just swell up inside of them and they would sense your forgiveness. You would give them peace and joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, Father, I pray right now they would sense your presence in their lives. And they would know that you will never leave them nor forsake them. And I thank you, Lord God, for hearing their prayer. I thank you for hearing their cry. I thank you for opening their heart to their need for Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that today will be the beginning of an exciting adventure for them as they walk and serve you. I pray for those who will be counseling with them down in the counseling rooms. You give them wisdom. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Praise your holy name. Understand that we have one of the Air Force's finest here with us this morning, Brother Monty Dallas, his son, Sister Esther Cook. Would you say, my brother? Amen. Give me a quick hand. God bless you, my brother. Brother Monty's stationed in the UK. Are you going back there? Okay. You want to be a big prayer for him. I was growing up in my community. That we held in high regard the men and women in the military service. And I think we still should hold in high regard. They are true heroes in our country, and they sacrifice their youthful years. They don't take safe, and keep his mother's heart encouraged. Amen.
Amen.
We'll be in prayer for those who've been counseled. Our heart is blessed today. Really blessed today. Really blessed today. Young man that was here, raised his hand. That was my good friend, Al Purdy's son. That's his good son. And I've been praying for him. I've been praying for him and his two brothers. Ever since their father died almost 3 years ago. It blessed my heart to see him here this morning. And see him raise my hand was a real blessing. And so be in prayer for him. I did not know the other two raised their hand. Be in prayer as they've been counseled. Amen?
Amen.
God's still on the throne.
Yes, Jesus.
Amen?
Amen.
Well, we do not have a service this evening. We'll give you one more week off. For the new year. Don't forget now, coming up this week, it's going to be the second, Brother Keith.
Yes.
On the second, January 2nd.